Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Glutton, a novel by A.K. Blakemore, read by Graham Halstead. Author's note: the action of this book begins and ends in September 1798, renamed in the French Republican calendar as Vendémiaire en Sept, year 7. The Republican calendar was introduced by the French National Convention in 1793 and remained in use until 1805, a highly symbolic break with the days of the Ancien Régime, which the Revolution had aimed to dismantle. The 12 months of this calendar were named by the poet Fabre d'Églantine, 1750 to 1794, who sought to suggest both the beauty of the changing seasons and the noble rhythms of agricultural labor through his designations. For instance, Vendémiaire is derived from the Latin vendemia, meaning grape gathering or grape harvest. How then, while they all go rushing at such a pace on unknown ways, with no bridle, towards no aim, can hurly-burly unutterable fail? For verily, not federation rose-pink is the color of this earth and her work, not by outbursts of noble sentiment, but with far other ammunition shall a man front the world. Thomas Carlyle. Vendémiaire the First, Year 7, Hospice Civil de l'Humanité, Versailles. To my esteemed colleague, citizen Dr. Jean-Pierre Dupuy, it is with deep and long-held admiration that I write to you, although the circumstances that cause me to do so are strange indeed. Believing time to be of the essence in this matter, I pray that my brevity causes no affront. 4 days ago, a person of exceedingly poor and alarming appearance arrived at our hospital and was placed under my care. The name he uses for himself is Terrard, and he says that he was a soldier and fought for the Republic in the North. He also asserts a past acquaintance with you, citizen Dr. Dupuy, though I can scarcely give credence to his account of himself. He can be no older than 25 by his looks. He claims, and indeed truly appears, to suffer greatly from some ailment that defies all diagnoses. His abdomen is distended, and his skin is yellowed and atrabilious as one sees in cases of severe inanition, and he is convulsed by pains that render him unable to stand and often unable to speak. He claims these pains are caused by a golden fork that he swallowed whole, and that is, and here I quote the patient's vivid self-diagnosis verbatim, tearing him apart inside, although manual examination of the patient revealed no such foreign body, nor any other obvious obstruction to the gut. His breathing has become labored, and he will now take neither food nor water. I believe he will soon die, and so does he. My sense of fraternal charity for this pitiful creature has overcome my natural temerity, and I am compelled to relay his desperate wish to see you and speak with you, knowing full well that your work may detain you in Paris. Although this poor Terrard may be beyond our healing art, he is certainly beyond mine, I believe it would ease his troubled and swift departing spirit to see you once again, and bid you come, if you are able, as soon as you might. Your humble servant, Citizen Dr. Alexis L. Tissier. 1. Les Paysans, the Peasants. Vendémiaire the Fourth, Year 7. They look like grave figures, the way they move along the dim corridors between the dim rooms. It is because their long habits hide the movements of their limbs and the muted shuffle of their feet on the bare stone tiles. Because their long habits disguise the movements of their limbs and the muted shuffle of their feet on the bare stone tiles, they look like they are gliding, as though it is some outside force that compels them along the dim corridors and between the dim rooms. They nod to one another when they pass. Sister Perpetue supposes she must look the same way they do, because she wears the same long habit and the same white cornette with the wide wings on top of her head. She supposes she must also look like it is some outside force compelling her along the dim passages and between the dim rooms, which she supposes, in a sense, is true. Love? God? Love and God being one and the same, of course. There are crosses nailed to the walls to show it. There are sisters gliding along the halls in their white cornets to show it. It is, or was, the day of autumn crocus. It was raining outside, heavily, the last time she was able to look out a window. Drowning the sooted cornice work and the shy evening lights of the city. There are crosses nailed to the walls, but there are very few windows. The windows that there are, on this floor of the hospital, are very small and barred. You can really lose your sense of time in this place. She knows what time it is now, though. She knows it is near midnight, because she has been called to the place where Sister Amandine watches the patient who must always be watched. Sister Amandine is sitting upright in a chair in the corridor with a prayer book open in her black lap. "You mustn't fall asleep," says Sister Amandine. "Why not?" asks Sister Perpetue. "Always these stupid questions," says Sister Amandine. "Because he must always be watched." "But you're looking at your book, not watching him at all." Sister Amandine closes the prayer book and presses her lips tightly together. "The patient has been given laudanum," she says, "for the pain. Now he is sleeping, and in any case, he is bound to his bed." "Why?" asks Sister Perpetue. "That was what I meant," she says. "I meant, why are such precautions necessary? Citizen Dr. Tissier says he is certainly dying." Sister Amandine leans forward slowly in her chair, red, big-knuckled hands still sandwiched around her little prayer book. "You mean you have not heard?" she asks. "I have heard," Sister Perpetue says, "things that could hardly be true. Could hardly be true if they were said of any man alive." Sister Amandine putters away down the corridor with a yawn, and yes, with the movement of her limbs hidden, the shuffling of her feet muted, so that she appears to glide away across the flagstones to her narrow bed in the dormitories. Sister Perpetue sits down. The chair faces the door of the patient's room. Sister Perpetue has heard that the man who lies in that room once ate a little child. There is more to it, of course. He worked up to eating a little child by eating other things first. Corks and stones, snakes and eels, dogs and cats, alive. She has heard how people would gather in the market squares and at the fetes to watch him tear the bellies of puppies open with his bare teeth there, among the organ grinders and the girls with yellow flowers in their hair. Christian souls would come to watch him do these things. He ate, she has heard, such quantities as seemed impossible, a whole bushel of apples, one after the other, hardly stopping, it was said, to breathe between bites. 3 large meat pies and 4 gallons of milk, 30 pounds of beef lung and liver, mesentery juices running down his chin. A medical marvel. He was a sight of rare, arresting hideousness, even in those times when severed heads were carried dripping through the street to viva and strewed tinsel. He had not wanted to be what he was, whatever you might call it, because he had gone to a doctor and he had said, "Cure me." All this Sister Perpetue has heard, and the doctor had tried to cure him with laudanum and eggs and enemas. But while the good doctor played with his leeches, the patient slunk around the shades of the hospital at night and discovered a new level of depravity there, where human meat lay prone, exposed, exuding. Sister Perpetue wishes she had brought a prayer book herself. She rearranges her kirtle. She looks at her shoes. She examines her nails and finds them to be exactly as they ought to be, and exactly as the rest of her is, short, round, spotless. She looks up and down the corridor, left, then right. She looks at the patient's door again, which stands very slightly ajar. Between door and jamb, she can see nothing but void, a bar of black. Having exhausted the possibilities for looking, Sister Perpetua begins to listen. In the court, the bell is rung for midnight, but after that, there is nothing. A dripping noise, perhaps, from somewhere nearby. The hospital is old, and the outside wills its way in, slowly. Drip. It could be rain in a pail, or blood in a basin. Either way, a dripping noise will hardly sustain her interest until matins. It is better, she tells herself, to spend the night here alone, in peace, than in the dormitories. In the dormitories where the patients are given numbers instead of names, and where their fitful breath sours the air, and the paupers with their speckled tongues wake crowing at the night. No, here she can be alone with her thoughts. She even says it aloud. It is better to be here than in the dormitories. She is a very bad nun. She thinks for a moment, just for a little bit of fun, she will say that aloud as well. I am a very bad nun. But she decides against it. At the very furthest end of the corridor, there is a window. Sister.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.